talk. Thank you for visiting us at the Buddhadasa Indapanno archive. I think you already know my first question. The difficult or easy one. Please, can you introduce yourself?
All right. Yes, I'm Rod Bucknell, at one stage known as Ariyananda Bhikkhu. I'm from Australia, and that's who I am. Yep.
So how did you ever become interested in Buddhism? Mm. And how did you ever hear about Buddhadasa?
Well, strangely, the period that we're talking about here is much the period that we heard of from Christopher. The mid-1960s was a time when everybody was interested in anything that came from India or had some sort of connection with India or spirituality in general. And so it was the same with me. Really what interested me was the notion of meditation. I wanted to learn about meditation, I wanted to do meditation. And in those days, if you were interested in meditation, the place to go was India. One went to India, found a guru, and got down to business. So I was heading for India when, in 1966, I think it probably was, I gave up my job and set off for in the general direction of India. So I had been to Thailand before, and so I liked Thailand. I had a very positive impression of it, so I thought I will go through by way of Bangkok and then search for a guru once I've got to India. I never got to India on that occasion. Passing through Bangkok, I met a novice, I think it was at Wat Pho, I was sightseeing at Wat Pho, and this young novice came up to me and started explaining to me all about the carvings there. And he said, why don't you come and stay in our Wat rather than paying for a hotel room? And I thought that's an interesting and good idea. So I went and stayed at his Wat there, and before long he was saying, you don't need to go to India if you want to learn meditation. We have meditation centers right here in Thailand, right here in Bangkok. And you can learn meditation here. So I took him up on that. And he took me to Wat Mahathat. And, what was the man's name? The teacher there who... it's terrible that I can't.
The Burmese one.
No, it's a Thai man.
Yeah, I forget too.
Yeah. But to cut the story short, I met the meditation master there. I liked the idea of learning under his guidance, and we arranged for me to move in and do a course there, a meditation course. Nobody told me how long it was going to take. I had sort of imagined that it was 2 or 3 days perhaps. So I was so naive. And but it really got me. I could see that there was something in this meditation. Now this was meditation in the Mahasi Sayadaw style. So ultimately the guru, the teacher was Burmese, if you look at it that way. And it was very intensive. It was very hard work. There was no way in the world that you could just decide that, I want to have an afternoon off today. I'd like to go sightseeing or something like that. No, this was absolutely one-pointed meditation from dawn to dusk each day. And I was pleased to find that although it was hard work and although it was a struggle in the beginning, it did bear fruit, and I became very impressed with the sorts of outcomes that came from that. And so I ended up staying for 6 weeks I was a little bit puzzled in the end when I took leave of the teacher that he gave me a certificate to say that I had done the course. I thought that's not quite what I had expected, but I promised him that I would continue, and he told me, because I had said I find it very hot here in Bangkok and I would rather be somewhere cooler, and I'd rather be somewhere in a forest environment rather than in the middle of a big city, and he advised me to go to a certain small monastery in Chiang Mai and look around. And so I ended up at Wat Umong, just a short distance outside of the city of Chiang Mai. And one of the things about Wat Umong was that they were very strong followers of Buddhadasa Bhikkhu, Ajahn Buddhadasa. And so I wasn't eligible to have a kuti to myself. They had a great big library building, and so I was given a spot on the floor of the library, sharing the floor with a few other people, and I continued with my meditation. But the thing I was going to say is that every morning, at crack of dawn, one would be woken by a recording of a talk by Ajahn Buddhadasa. So this was how every day began, with a Dhamma talk by Ajahn Buddhadasa. So I asked people, who is this person that we hear every morning? And they told me he's a teacher from the south of Thailand. You must meet him someday. You must talk with him someday. And another thing they said was, you see these books all around. This was the library. You see, quite a big hall full of books. These books, most of them are the talks of the Venerable Buddhadasa. And another thing that you should do one of these days is get someone to tell you what's in these books and tell you what the Venerable Buddhadasa has to say. So these were two things that I put away in the back of my mind. That's how I came to know Buddhadasa. And ultimately, I ended up, it's a longer story, I'll just give a brief summary so you've got the general picture. I ended up becoming convinced that I wanted to really find out what this chap had to say. The elderly gentleman who was supporting the Wat Umong, Chaochun Sirorot is his full name. He was very keen to have me stay, and everyone was saying, oh, you must become a monk someday. And I wasn't at all sure about that at that stage. But I did become interested in what I heard. And so, first of all, there were a few of his books translated into English. And I think it was probably, what was the name of that Indian man?
Nagasena.
He was equally interested in the teachings of Buddhadasa, and he encouraged me also too. So I read just a few translations. And then the day came when, you know, everyone was saying, well, ultimately you should be doing the translation yourself. So there were lots of good advice from all quarters, but I was not quite sure that I was that committed. But anyhow, to cut a long story short, I did decide that I was going to stay on. I'd initially come with, I think I had my visa allowed me to stay for 1 month, but I ended up getting a 1 year residency permit, and I ended up deciding that I was going to become a monk. So that took me 9 months to make that decision. So I was ordained by Panyananda Bhikkhu, at Wat Chonlapratan. He became my preceptor and my teacher. And of course, he's very close to Venerable Buddhadasa, and so was Chao Chuen. So there were these influences from all directions. But it was some time before I actually got to meet Ajahn Buddhadasa at Suan Mokkh.
Chao Chuen had tried very hard to recruit Ajahn Buddhadasa to come to Wat Humong.
Yeah.
It was a famous historical temple that had run down, and he was the main person who helped it renovate. And Ajahn Buddhadasa wasn't willing to go, so he convinced Longpa Panya, who at that time was in Malaysia. And Longpa Panya became nationally known while he was the abbot in Chiang Mai for 15 years.
Yes.
But
right.
By the time you were there, he had already left, it seems.
That's right. So he was a sort of nominal abbot, I suppose, also of Wat Humong, as well as being actually located at Wat Chon Le Prathan. And he came occasionally, and I got to know him, and so I was ordained at Wat Chon Le Prathan, actually. Yeah. That's how I of course I got to know Ajahn Buddhadasa in person, only by going to stay at Suan Mokkh, but that came later. So it was about.
Because you had some relationship with Chao Chuen, who was very important for Ajahn Buddhadasa becoming known in northern Thailand, because he was from the south, people spoke a somewhat different language. Important cultural differences, historical differences. So I think if something more about your relationship with Chao Chuen, because part of Ajahn Buddhadasa's history is also people like Chao Chuen, as well as monks like Longpa Panya. So memories you have of your interactions with Chao Chuen, I think also help us understand the kind of people who, Thai people as well, who were drawn to Ajahn Buddhadasa and how he encouraged them and what they did.
Yeah, so Chao Chuen was very much an influence during that period. Of course, he was the one who in the first place, he was the supporter of Wat Humong. He had put all the effort and the money into getting it into a viable state, and you know, so it was his little brainchild to restore this ancient decaying temple and get it up and running again. I quite soon came to feel he was very much a sort of father figure. You know, he was not a monk, but he was a very dedicated Buddhist and very dedicated to spreading the word. And I think in the long run, he always hoped that I would, after having learned all the things one needed to know, go back to my hometown, my home country anyway, and perhaps become a teacher in some role or other. I, in fact, ended up becoming a university lecturer and researcher, and so I did actually, his dream did come true in that sense. But as I was going through that initial 9-month period of sort of settling in and deciding what I wanted to do, at one stage I said, I see that, you know, the monks, they don't eat after midday. So I would like to adopt that practice too. I had been eating in the evenings, and in fact, I would always go and eat that evening meal with Chao Chun, because he was an elderly gentleman. He used to just eat in his kuti, and so I would go and join him in his kuti for the evening meal. So it was quite a family sort of relationship. It was like a fatherly role that he was playing there. And I may say that you may recall I said in the beginning that I was going to India initially. This was my original intention. So I came to Thailand with a very little real knowledge of Buddhism. And it was the meditation in Bangkok at Wat Mahathat that persuaded me to look further. This was interesting. This was something that I had to look further into. And the thing about Wat U Mong was that, first of all, it was a forest wat in a big teak forest with kutis scattered around. Very pleasant environment. And they had quite a library there. So that was where I lived, in the library. And so I did a lot of reading. I continued my...
In Thai or in English?
Now see, this is where a swing happens, because all these books by Buddhadasa that they were showing me, there were a few in English, but most of them...
Like three, maybe.
Yes, not even a handful. And but there were rows and rows of books in Thai, and these were not actually, as far as I gathered, they were not books that Ajahn Buddhadasa had written. They were records of his teachings on many different occasions.
So very few. He did some writing in his first 10 years when he largely lived by himself. Mm. But most of the books were from talks.
Yeah. So here I was sleeping on the floor every night in the midst of all this and not really having much idea what treasures may lie hidden in there. And so I decided, well, in any case, of course, it was going to be a very good idea to master the Thai language. And so that was my first task. And then to go on and discover what these books contained. So people were telling me that you should get into them, you know. And so I went to the shelves and I just sort of grabbed a handful of books and pulled them off the shelves. They were these rather flimsy paperback books that are produced very cheaply, no doubt, here in Thailand. And I pulled out a handful of books, and lo and behold, I just had my hand around the backs of the books, the spines of the books, but the rest of the book was completely gone. It had been eaten away by termites. And then I learnt this very useful Thai phrase, Mokkh, the ants have come up. the ants have got up and chewn away all the body of the books. And this went all along the shelves, and nobody had been aware of this. The books were sitting there, and they'd been eaten away by ants, and nobody had noticed. So, well, anyway, everyone was listening to the morning recording, so they didn't need to look at the books. But anyway, Chao Chun encouraged me, and with the assist, I had a book teach, I forget what it was called, but it meant teach yourself Thai, Mary Haas. Yeah, what's that book called? Anyway.
I know her dictionaries.
Yeah, I had that too. Yeah, but this was a step by step course in Thai, and then there was a young novice who was sort of assigned to me, and I sat down and started translating a book that Chao Chun recommended, which was Dhamma Kapnak Saksa, Buddha Dhamma for students. And I've later found that it also has a different title, Laktam Samram Laksaksa, Dhamma for students, once again. Like the sutras, they often have various different titles. So little by little, and with my tutor, and with help from Chao Chun, and with my own natural curiosity for languages and my fondness for linguistics generally, by the end of about a year and a half, I had translated my way slowly through that book. Now, I've got to mention, this is a little bit out of chronological sequence, but the most important thing to mention is that, of course, after 9 months at Wat U Mong, I came the ordination, and at that stage, I still was just learning Thai, and so this is about another 9 months after that I completed the first translation. I don't know if this will be confirmed by the by Paco's researchers, but I'm a little bit unclear in my mind just what the chronology was. But anyhow, so that's how the interest in Buddhadasa came about, because I found that a very good little book for someone who was basically a beginner. I felt I was a beginner. You know. The library was full of there were lots of English books in the library, but that little book of Buddhadasa's was a very good way to begin, I felt, because he asks just questions. He's asking questions that a foreigner might ask a monk here in Thailand. And how would you answer that question? So that was the sort of book it was. And so each question was, the question and the answer were not much more than a page out of a little book like that. It was very a good way to make a start, I thought.
Yeah. Until this day, it's being used, this translation. It has been revised, but it's now even being used on social media. So they are like weekly posts. One of those Buddha Dhamma for students questions will be posted on the social media.
I didn't know that.
Facebook.
Yes. You don't want to name brands. But show you that it's still very much used.
Oh, that's very encouraging to know that. Yeah. Because one starts wondering, is this going any further, or does it stop here? Obviously, it doesn't
still
stop.
Very appropriate, and your translation, the revision was minor, but when we wanted to reprint it, it had to be typeset. Mm. It wasn't possible then to. So it was typeset, and then in the process, a little editing. But the revision was trivial. Mm. And so now it's that which shall not be named.
Yeah, so that was how it began. And then I took another hint from your excuse. I took another hint from the Yom. I might consider translating Pasakon, Pasatam, two kinds of language. I translated it. I perhaps should have been more literal with the title. I might save that up for tomorrow, because that's what I'm going to be talking about, the two kinds of language. But that was how it got going, and then I became slightly more ambitious, and then there was rather longer books. So Dhammaka, no, what was the other one you mentioned?
Handbook for Mankind.
That's it, yes, Handbook for Mankind. And another one?
Why Were You Born?
Yes. Okay, so I know there were five altogether, if I'm not mistaken. There was a sixth one, which it went in with some translations by Santikaro. Looking within.
Looking within. Yes. Mm.
I never quite discovered whether that ended up being printed. I'm sure it must have.
Show you in the archive.
Okay, good. Yeah, so then I basically, the translation and my own meditation practice, and of course visiting Suan Mokkh, which I did at least twice.
So which circumstances led you to actually go and visit Suan Mokkh from working on?
Oh, well, I mean, if you know, Ajahn Buddhadasa was not going to come to Wat U Mong, so I'll go to Suan Mokkh. It's as simple as that. And so I found it a very good experience. Also, of course, with being with the actual person, and there were some interesting other monks there. Some of the names that you two were mentioning just before, you know. Pasatiko was not actually there at that time. He was with Bangkok at Ajahn Lapotan, but Wimalaw was there, and then another Western monk was Sadar Lorca. You may have heard of him, but he was not resident in Thailand ever. He was actually based in Hong Kong, and he came for a visit of about a month, and so I got to know him there, and all that contributed. And so there was the meditation, the translation work, and the general more systematic study of this thing we call Buddhism. And I realized that it's not enough to read the translations of the texts. I wanted to read Pali too, but I was a bit slow to get started on that. But by the time I completed my 4 years as a bhikkhu, I was a different sort of person. Yeah.
And when you met Ajahn Buddhadasa, did you discuss translation with him?
Yes, he was all in favour. Yeah. I don't think he ever actually suggested any particular book that I might consider doing. I don't recall him ever doing that. I think what I discovered was that I was particularly interested in this one particular teaching of his, one particular aspect of his understanding of the Dharma, was the notion of pasākon, pasātam, human language and Dhamma language. It really clicked with me.
Mm. And do you remember the actual condition of the very first meeting with Ajahn Buddhadasa? Your first arrival in
Wat U Mong? Oh, dude, no, I really don't, I'm afraid.
That's almost 50 years ago.
It's 40-something years, that's right, for sure, yeah. But one little thing, he felt that that's what I should be doing, you know. He didn't want me to read any books. I mean, I was there, I think I must have spent a pansa there, the full 3 months. And he was very happy for me to be translating while I was there. But he really didn't want me to. He had quite a library, I'm sure, inside his kuti. I never got to see it. But he says, you've got to stay focused. So that's what I did. But I must say, I was impressed by the environment, and I was impressed by all the things that were going on. People were doing whatever they were good at doing. Like, if someone was a good artist, then he was painting paintings. And somebody else was good at carpentry, and he was doing carpentry. And so there was no one rule for everybody, but just make it a kamatana, make it an exercise in meditation, exercise in mindfulness.
Do you see any teaching of Ajahn Buddhadasa which would be particularly relevant for today, for the society of today?
Yes, well, I'm I'm hoping to learn something at these next few days, because I realize that my own knowledge of what Ajahn Buddhadasa had to say is very focused on what I was interested in. And I suppose that's very natural. But I was quite aware that he was very concerned about all sorts of very practical things that had nothing obviously to do with meditation he's interested in social issues and was often quite critical of the way things were being done right here in Thailand, and he had he probably made a few foes, a few enemies through being outspoken about things that people didn't want anyone to speak about, and so he was a kind of social rebel in a way. Now I've always thought that I don't want to say anything about politics, so I have nothing to say about that myself. Well, at that time, I've changed my I've become more liberal about all that in the meantime, but I gather from what I have heard from other people that Ajahn Buddhadasa had a lot to say about social issues. He had a lot to say about the Sangha, about the conduct of the Sangha, and this of course came up in some of his talks, and he was very prepared to speak out, and rightly so, I'd say.
And for yourself, is there anything that has made an influence on you until today from meeting Ajahn Buddhadasa personally?
Yeah. Well, the first thing was, I mean, this is of course the whole reason why I was here at all, was that he taught me about Buddhism and about the Buddha's teachings. So these books that I was translating, these were very good introduction for someone like myself who wanted to find out what the Buddha was on about, what his teaching was. And here I was getting it from a person who really knew the answers to those sorts of questions. And so there were lots of things that for me as a sort of beginner when I first came to Thailand, I found that this thing we call Buddhism or Buddha Dhamma was not something that I could sort of just take on board at first meeting. It was a long, slow process, and there were things that for a long time I never got the hang of it. What does this mean? What is he talking about? And I found that Buddhadasa's notion of everyday language and Dhamma language very helpful. And as Buddhadasa explains it, for example, every Thai person knows the story of the Buddha to be meditating and Mara coming along and trying to interrupt his meditation and distract him and so on. At first glance it sounds like a sort of myth. I mean, who's this Mara fellow, you know, and where does he fit in? There's nothing about him in the history books. What's going on here? So that is an example of Dhamma language, and Mara is not an actual flesh and bones person or god or demon or someone like that. Mara is a sort of figurative representation of distracting thoughts or distracting whatever it is, anything that distracts from your movement along the Noble Eightfold Path. You can put that under the heading of Mara. Right? And so this kind of thing was very helpful to me. And so I realized, as Buddhadasa's teachings gradually make you realize, that we often have to look for the meaning behind the words. And so the meaning, the actual gist of what is being said is sometimes not immediately apparent. You've just got to think outside the square a little bit. And the main overall message is that usually we tend to look outwards to find the meaning, you know? Something around us, something in the world outside is what he's talking about. But no, what the Buddha is talking about is inside. It's all about the world inside our heads and our emotions and so on. It's all that he's talking about. He's talking about what's going on inside. And what's going on outside is of secondary importance to that, and that is not new. A lot of that we know already. And the scientists and the physicists and scientists of every kind learning about the world outside. But the world inside remains, for most people, a complete mystery. Or else most of us are not even aware that there's anything going on inside. And yet there's so much going on inside our heads and inside our whole being. And that's what Buddhadasa indirectly was saying. So he's saying, so that book, Looking Within, the title is very much a summary of his approach. And it's nothing new. I mean, the Buddha was saying exactly that, but it's very easily forgotten. And so it was not news to me in a way, because of course the whole reason why I was interested in meditation was because I was, to some extent, to a very shallow extent, aware that there's all sorts of stuff going on inside that we don't know about and that we don't know how to deal with. And we don't know how to come to terms with it. And so what I was reading in these translations that I was doing myself was that was the main message that came out of it, that it's all about what's going on inside. What's going on outside, we sort of know how to deal with that in most cases, but what's going on inside is where we should be looking.
Well, thank you, Ajahn.
And thank you for inviting me to come and be part of this very interesting process. And thank you also to all the people who are behind. I know I've seen, met just a few of you, but I know there's a whole team working behind the scenes. So thank you all. And thank you for asking me to come along, Paco. Very much appreciated.